Good afternoon. Today we will be beginning the next unit, which is unit 3. And as I said, each unit covers a layer of your ISO OSI model, so a TCP/IP model. So in this unit, we will be covering the network layer, so which is the layer 3 of your OSI model. And the network layer is important because it is responsible for the transmission of data from one host to the other host located in different networks. So basically, if you want to transfer data not from one node to another node, but from one network to another network, then the network layer is quite important. It also takes care of forming a packet. So in the previous layer, in the data link layer, we have seen the formation of streams and what all is added in a stream. But here in the network layer, the data is transferred in the form of packets, and packet routing is performed over here. That is, we use some network routing algorithms or routing algorithms, where what is the criteria? Whenever you are transferring data from one network to another, then we have to select the shortest path to transmit the packet from the number of routes available. So we will have a number of routes available. So if we see over here, this can be given as the diagram for the network. Yeah. So this is a simple switched network. So over here, these are the different switches from one node to another, switching nodes we call them. So from one node to another, we can the packet can travel. So over here, from suppose if we are sending the message from personal computer B to the personal computer E, then we should make sure that the network layer selects the shortest path available from, because we will, if you notice, we have a number of routes available. So from here we have to select the shortest path, and also the sender's and receiver's IP address. So whenever we are talking about different networks, there will be IP address. So in that case, we need to make sure that the sender and receiver IP address is available on the packet that is being sent. So this is the functionality of the network layer. So what do you mean by the IP address? It is the internet protocol address, right? So internet protocol address is a unique address that identifies your device, that identifies the device or the personal computer on a given network. So for that that IP address should be available on the packet that is being sent. So the sender and receiver's IP addresses are also placed in the packet. Now, what is a packet? Basically, packet is similar to a frame. That is, whenever your data is enclosed in a frame, and data is enclosed in the packet where we add the sender's IP address, the receiver IP address, and then we give it to the data link layer. Then the data link layer will take this packet and convert it into a frame. Okay, so over here, the sender's and receiver's IP address are added by the network layer. Now, what are the functionalities of your network layer? If you go back to your first unit, you can remember that the functionalities are routing. That is, the network layer decides which route is suitable from the source to the destination. So as I said over here, from the personal computer B, if I want to send data to personal computer E, suppose, then the network layer is supposed to decide which switches it should select or which nodes it should select. And this functionality, this is the routing. And apart from that, it also has another function, which is logical addressing. So in order to identify each device on the network uniquely, what network layer does is it defines an addressing scheme that the sender and receiver's IP address are placed in the header. So as I just said, the IP addresses of both the sender and the receiver is placed on the in the header of the network layer, and that address is very unique. So the packet which is to be sent will have the sender's address and the receiver's address, and then it will be given to the data link layer. So now we'll just go back to the OSI model and see which layer we are studying. So In the previous, that is in unit 1, we have studied a bit of physical layer. Then the unit 2 entirely comprised of data link layer. And now in unit 3, we are studying the network layer. So network layers, we are studying the what kind of nodes are used in between to transfer the data. And we are even studying the IPv4 and IPv6, that is the logical addressing format, then the routing protocols, and what are all the other functions of the network layer. So here, if you remember, the network layer is basically to transfer data from one network to another. So if you notice this interface, which is network is transferring from one network to another. And also, then we have the functionality of network layer. Here, from the transport layer, the data is given to the network layer and it will add its own header. Now we know what is in the header. In the header, we have the senders and receivers IP address. So senders and receivers IP address. And that is given again to the data link layer. So network layer adds its own addresses, that is, it adds its own header and then it is given to the data link layer. This is on the sender side. On the receiver side, what will happen? On the receiver side, it will take the frame from the, it will actually take the data from the data link layer. So it is taking the data from the data link layer and it will extract this header and simply pass the data to the transport layer. So here, if you notice, the network layer is responsible for the delivery of individual packets from the source host to the destination host. And how it is done, the source to destination delivery is basically we send the data to intermediate systems or intermediate switches. Now we know what are we sending it to. We are sending it to the intermediate switches. And you remember the concept of hop-to-hop delivery. Hop-to-hop delivery is done for data link layer. That is from one node to another node in the same system. But here on the network layer, we have the source to destination delivery. Okay. So from network layer, directly it will go on to the network. Network A is supposed is sending to sending data to network F. Then from it will select a route. Either it can go to A, B, E, F, or it can go to A, B, C, D. Now, depending on upon the time taken or the distance it is traveling, it will decide on the route to be taken. So now we can proceed with our unit 3. So as I said, we will be studying the switching techniques, circuit and packet concept. Then we have logical addressing, IPv4, IPv6, and NAT and subnetting concepts. Then we'll be studying, so unit 3 is actually divided into 3 parts as you see over here. So first is the network layer overview. Then we will be seeing some detailed protocols in the IPv4, IPv6 header, that is ARP, RARP, these are the internet control protocols. And apart from that, a few concepts of tunneling, fragmentation. Then the routing. The routing is an important functionality of the network. So we will be seeing the network routing algorithms. So in that, we will be having a delivery, then forwarding and unicast routing protocols and the gateway protocols. So now let's begin with the first topic, which is the switching techniques or switching techniques concept. So basically, first we have to understand the term switching and what do we mean by switching and what are the different switching techniques. So first and foremost, we have to understand that whenever we are talking about transmission of data beyond the local area, that is transmitting the data from source to destination through a network of intermediate switching nodes. Now, switching is basically in computer network, it helps in deciding the best route for data transmission if there are multiple paths in a larger network. So as you have seen the diagram that I've just shown you, if we have multiple routes, then switching is basically used to decide which path is best for the transmission of packets or transmission of data from one node to another node. So this switched network design is used to implement LANs. So whenever we are talking about LANs, the local area networks, we have multiple nodes, right? And we will have multiple routes. Then in that case, we need to have a switched network to decide which route to be used. So the switching nodes are not concerned with the content of the data. Basically, their purpose is to provide a switching facility that will move the data from one node to another until they reach their destination. So the devices attached to the network can be referred to as stations. So let's just see the diagram over here first. Yeah. So these devices that are attached to the network are referred as stations. So this can be station one, station two. Now that station might be anything. It might be a computer, terminal, telephone, mainframe, or any communicating device. So basically, whenever we are talking about a network, we will have a station. And these stations are connected to switching devices. So these are your switching devices or switching nodes, which are known as simply nodes. So we will have two things over here. We will have stations, which are the communicating devices, and we will have nodes to provide communication. So these are the communicating devices, which needs to send or receive data. And nodes are for providing communication. Okay. Now, nodes are connected to one another in some topology. It might be the bus topology, ring topology. Some topology is there for the connection of nodes. And each station attaches to a node. So, if you notice, the station B is attached to node 1. Station C is attached to node 2. So basically, each station is attached to a node. And this collection of nodes is referred to as communication network. So this is referred as a communication network. And in this switched communication network, so since we have multiple switches, in the switched communication network, data entering the network from a station are routed or are sent through a route to the destination by being switched from node to node. So maybe if I'm sending data from B to E, then B will give it to 1, and then 1 will decide whether it is to be given to 2 or 4, and this way the data will be given to the network, the station E. So for this, for example, if I want to pass the data from station A to station F, then from station A, it will be given to node 4. Then from node 4, we can give it to 7, 6, and F. Now you can notice a few things. The first and foremost is some nodes connect only to other nodes. So notice, suppose 5, the node 5, is simply connected to 4 and 6. It is not connected to a station. So what is their task? Their task is to basically switch the data internally. And other nodes have one or more stations attached as well. So if you notice 1, 4, 6, 6 has two stations. So it is possible to have one node attached to multiple stations also. And node station links are generally point-to-point links. That is, we have from station B to node 1, we have a dedicated link, and these are usually multiplex links. That is, we can send the data either by using frequency division multiplexing or time division multiplexing. And also, the network is not fully connected, that there is not, if you notice, 1 and 5 does not have a dedicated link. So it is not necessary that the network must be fully connected. However, it should be possible that there must be one possible path through the network for each pair of stations. So that is, from B, we should have a path from B to D, B to E, and B to F. It should be there so that it is easier to transfer the data. So this, if there's one possible path from each station to the other station, then what it does is it increases the reliability of the network. Now, whenever we are talking about the switching networks or the switched networks, you have to understand that there are two types, or actually there were three types, but since in our syllabus it has been given that it has been specifically mentioned that we are studying only the two types. So basically, switching techniques are, let me just write it over here. Switching techniques are actually divided into circuit switching and packet switching according to the syllabus. There is one more switching, which is message switching, which is not generally used. So message switching exists, but we are not studying it. So because in circuit switching is used for voice over communications, and packet switching is used, actually was developed around in 1970s, and it's still the basic concept of packet switching still remains the same. In packet switching, we have two types of approaches. One is the datagram approach, and the other is the virtual circuit approach. So let's see this once again. In switching techniques, in the syllabus, we have two types of switching that we are supposed to study. The first is the circuit switching, and the next is the packet switching. And in the case of packet switching, we have two types of approach. One is the datagram approach and the other is the virtual circuit approach. Now let's go back. So I've given you a general overview of the switching techniques concept. Now, so long distance transmission is typically done over a network of switched nodes. Now, why do we require switching? As I said, switching is basically for helping the network to decide which is the best route for data transmission if there are multiple paths. So nodes are not concerned with the content of data, and end devices are stations, that is a computer, terminal, phone, mainframe, etc. And the collection of nodes and connections is a communications network. And data routed by data, how is it sent or how is it sent to the route? It is done by switching from node to node. Now, what is the next thing? Nodes may connect to other nodes only or to stations and other nodes. So nodes may be simply connected to the other nodes, as I said, examples for node 5 and even node 7, if you notice. And node to node links are usually multiplexed. And what kind of multiplexing do we use? We use frequency division multiplexing or time division multiplexing. And network is usually partially connected, and some redundant connections are desirable for reliability. Now, if we want a reliable connection, then it is better to have a connection from each station to another station, or a path from each station, at least a single path from one station to another station. And what are the two different switching technologies that we are studying? We are studying about circuit switching and packet switching. And I've explained you all of these things with the help of a diagram also. Now, first and foremost, we'll be studying about the circuit switching. Now, circuit switching is basically, what it does is, it has a dedicated path between the sender and the receiver. And before the data transfer, connection will be established first. And the best example of circuit switching is the telephone network. So communication via circuit switching implies that there is a dedicated communication path. Now, this is very, very important. Why? Because whenever you are talking about circuit switching, so in this diagram, first and foremost, suppose if A wants to communicate to B, then first and foremost, A must decide which path it is using, and it should decide on all the switches that it will go through. So if suppose A wants to send the data, so directly it will have to go through this switch, then it will pass from here. You can choose any one of the routes. So I'm choosing this, and this is done. So first and foremost, there should be a dedicated communication path. Once this connection is established, then only the A will start transferring the data. And once the data has been transferred, the circuit will be disconnected. So this is the concept of circuit switching. So let's just see the, yeah. So Whenever we are talking about circuit switching, the path is a connected sequence of links between the network nodes. So as I have just drawn those arrow lines, red arrows, that is a path from A to B. Now on each physical link, a logical channel is dedicated to the connection. So basically, whenever we are talking about the circuit switching, on each link, some connection is given to the transfer of the data, whichever is being sent. So from A to B, whatever data is being sent, the link, what it does is, it says that this is the channel that I'm giving for the transfer of the data. And now communication via circuit switching is basically, as I said, of three phases. The first is the circuit establishment, then we will be transferring the data, and then the circuit will be disconnected. So before any signals can be transmitted, an end-to-end circuit must be established. So as in the previous slide here, we will be So this is the end-to-end circuit that we are establishing. So if A is sending the data to B, then what should happen? There should be a dedicated line from A to B. So here, if I'm naming the switches as 1, 2, 3, and 4, then we should have, we should know that from A, the data is being given to 1, then 2, 3, and 4, and then finally B. It is reaching the system or the station B. So over here, a dedicated path is established. And once it is established, now we can transfer the data. So for the transferring of data, now data can be transmitted from the network A to the network B. And what is the transmission medium? Now the transmission medium can be analog or digital depending on the network. And if the data is being transferred completely, once the data has been transferred completely, the circuit must be disconnected. Why? Because in the case of circuit establishment, as I said, the nodes or the links are dedicating some part of its channel to the transfer of data from A to B. So to retrieve that, that circuit is disconnected. So after the period of data transfer, the connection is terminated, or we can say disconnected, any one of the terms, by the action of one of the two stations. So stations, what one of either A or B must disconnect the circuit. So this is the concept of circuit switching. Now, what is another thing? While we are transferring the data, it must have switching capacity and the channel capacity to establish the connection, and it must be intelligent to work out the routing also. So first and foremost, now we have to note that the connection path is established before the data transmission begins. So we have seen that before the data transfer begins, we have established the connection, and some part of the channel must be reserved for the transfer of data from A to 1 and so on. Now the switches must be intelligent to allocate. So the switches themselves are allocating the data, right? So they should know that how much capacity of data to be allocated for this transmission from A to B. Now what is the problem over here? First and foremost, circuit switching can be inefficient. Why? Because channel capacity, the capacity of the channel, we are giving some capacity of the channel for the transfer of the data during the duration the circuit has been established, right? So even if no data is being transferred, the capacity is not being used, so ineffective basically. And for a voice connection, utilization will be high. So whenever we are talking about circuit switching, it is usually used for voice connections, because when if two people are talking on the phone, suppose the person A, station A, and station B are two persons, then how does a voice connection occur? First and foremost, a connection is established, then you can continuously keep on sending the data. But even then, utilization for a voice connection is also not 100%. And for a client server or terminal to computer connection, the capacity might be idle. So for voice, it is good, but for client server models, when we don't send data for all the time, then it is not efficient. So whenever we are talking about performance, there is a delay. Why? Because the circuit needs to be established. So for some time, till the circuit is established, there will be a delay in sending the data. However, once the circuit is established, the network is easy to use and we can keep on sending the data continuously. And the information that we are sending is fixed at a fixed data rate. That is, there is no delay because the connection is not with some other. Basically, when we are sending the data over here, suppose we are sending from A to B, then this connection is established. And even if C wants to use the same, then there has to be another, the switches need to decide what kind of allocation they need to do. So this connection won't be interrupted. So in the previous unit, if you remember the data link layer, we have studied about the connection, there's a collision being occurred. So in this case, there will won't be any chance of collision or delay. So the delay at each node will be negligible in this case, because the switches, once the connection has been established, they won't share the connection with any other system or station. Now, whenever I'm talking about system or station or a computer terminal, in that case, all I'm referring is to this end systems. And whenever I'm talking about nodes, then these will be the switching nodes or the switches, okay? Now, what about the circuit switching applications? It is inefficient. That is once the channel capacity is dedicated for a duration of connection. And if you're not sending any data, then the capacity is wasted. And the setup of connection takes time. And once it is connected, the transfer is transparent. That is, we'll be able to know what kind of data is being sent. And it was developed for the voice traffic or phone. Okay, so for voice transfer, the circuit switching was good. Now, we will be seeing the public circuit switched network. So as I said, the circuit switching was developed to handle voice traffic, but sometimes it is also used for the data traffic. The best known example of the circuit switching network is the public telephone network. And if you can see this diagram, this is actually a collection of the national networks interconnected to form an international service. So first and foremost, we will be seeing this. Another well-known application of the circuit switching is the private branch exchange. What is this private branch exchange? It is given over here, if you notice. It is used to connect. So earlier, in the earlier times, we used to have a telephone which used to interconnect different phones. So you had to call it an exchange, and that exchange used to connect to telephone in the another city. So suppose if you're talking from city A to city B, then there used to be an exchange in the middle. Not exactly in the middle. I'm talking in terms of logical explanation. So here somewhere there used to be an exchange, and whenever a person from city A calls to city B, then the exchange used to transfer the line to the city B. So basically, circuit switching is also used in private networks, and typically such a network is set up by a corporation or other large organization. So if you notice the phones in the, even in schools and offices and educational institutions, you can, hotels, you have this, you have the network of phones in such a way that suppose if you simply dial 9, you will get to the reception. And if you're dialing 1, you will get into the administration office. We even have it in our college. That is, whenever you dial a single digit number, then you will be connected to another phone in the organization. So that is also a example of the circuit switching, and that is also done by the exchange. So in between, so right now we don't have a physical exchange. The circuit switching has developed so much that we don't need a physical presence of an exchange. But basically, the line is being transferred from one room or one office to another in the same organization. And the data switch, another common example of circuit switching is the data switch. What is that? The data switch is similar to the private branch exchange, but it is designed to interconnect digital data. Now, a public telecommunication network, you will see, can be described by using four things. So first is the subscriber. This diagram basically explanation. So first we will have the subscriber. Then we will have the subscriber line. Subscriber line. Exchange. And then trunk. Now, what is the subscriber? The devices which are attached to the network are the subscribers, and most subscriber devices are connected to the public telecommunications network. And what is the subscriber line? Now, the link between the subscriber and the network is known as the subscriber line, and it is usually done by the twisted pair wire. After that, we have the exchanges. The switching center in the network is basically the exchange, and the trunks are the branches between the exchanges. So one from one exchange to another exchange is the trunk. Okay. So the branches between the exchanges are the trunks, and trunks carry multiple voice frequency. That is, they have the concept of multiplexing. And which multiplexing will they use? They'll either use frequency division multiplexing or time division, synchronous time division multiplexing. So here we have the telecom components. Subscribers are the devices attached to the network, and subscriber line will have a local loop or subscriber loop, and there might be up to few kilometers, up to few tens of kilometers. Then we have the exchange, which is the switching centers, and the trunk is a branch between the exchange, and they use the concept of multiplexing. So in these times, the circuit switching technology is mainly used, as I said, for voice traffic. And one of the key requirements of what is the important criteria of voice traffic, the important criteria of voice traffic is there should be no transmission delay. That is, suppose if you're saying hello, and after that you're saying how are you, then there should not be any delay between hello and how are you. So for that reason, circuit switching is best used, because there is no transmission delay in the case of circuit switching networks. Now, circuit switching is even now used in the world predominantly because of this thing, which is the voice traffic or voice transmission of voice signals. Even though in today's digital world, we don't use circuit switching as much that we had used earlier, but even then, circuit switching will always remain quite attractive for the users because of the reason for both local area and wide area network, that is for both LANs and WANs, because first and foremost is this, and also then the next is because it is transparent. Now, what do you mean by transparent? The thing is, once a circuit is established, so if once we do the first, as I said, it has three phases, right? So once this is the first phase, circuit establishment. So once a circuit has been established, it will remain as a direct connection between the two stations. So it is a direct connection between the two stations. Okay. So if it is a direct connection between the two stations, then there might not be any collision, or we don't need to apply any other protocols for the circuit switching. For that reason, even now, circuit switching networks are used in the real world. Now, after that, we will see a few of the circuit switching concepts, and then we can proceed with packet switching. So to understand the circuit switching approach, how a circuit switching is done, it is easier to understand it with a single circuit switching node. So this is a circuit switch node, and a network is built around this single circuit switching node. What it does is it consists of a collection of stations and attached to this central switching unit. Now, what is the central switching unit? The central switching unit establishes a path between any two devices that wishes to communicate. So this diagram that I have over here is basically one such node network. So this is one node network. And the dotted lines inside this are the switches which symbolize the connection. So these switches are connected to each other. So these dotted lines represent the connections that are currently active. Now, what is the important thing in this circuit switch? The most important thing will be the digital switch. Now, what is this digital switch and what is its function? The function of the digital switch is to provide a transparent signal between the devices. And the path is transparent in that it appears to be attached to the pair of devices. That is, there is a direct connection between them, as you can see. And the connection is usually full duplex. So the signal must be full duplex transmission. That is, you can transfer in both the directions. And next, we have the network interface. It represents the functions and hardware needed. So usually, whenever you are talking about a connection to a network, in the computers or laptops, we have something known as a network interface card, NIC. So that is the hardware needed to connect the digital devices. And then we have the control unit. It performs three tasks. The first is establishing the connection on demand. Then after the establishment of the connection, it must maintain the connection. So first establish, then maintain, then it should disconnect. Once the demand has been done or once the data has been sent, it should disconnect. So this is the circuit switching concept, and we will just see it over here. So the circuit switching concept is it is a digital switch which provides transparent signal path between devices. Then we have a network interface, and then the control unit. Control unit is very important because it establishes the connection. How should it establish, or when should it establish? It should establish the connection on demand, acknowledge the request, determine if the destination is free, and then construct a path. After that, it should maintain that connection until the complete data transfer is done. It should maintain the connection and then finally disconnect. So this will conclude the circuit switching concept. Tomorrow, or in the next class actually, we'll be seeing the packet switching principles or concept. And as I said, in packet switching, we'll be studying two approaches. First is the datagram approach, and then next is the virtual approach.